In the earlier class, we were discussing about the leukotrienes, the prostaglandins and the different type of the prostaglandin receptor. And in this class, we will discuss about the leukotriene receptors. And of course, the leukotrienes are also the attacks, and there are separate receptors, especially a leukotriene B4 type of the receptor, especially BLT1 and BLT2 type of the receptors are there. And for the cystinyl LTs or LTC4 and LTD4 have been very well defined. And so two subtypes of the receptors are there, that is cystinyl LT1 and cystinyl LT2 are the important receptors for the leukotriene circuits. And all the leukotrienes are coupled with GQ protein and function through the inositol triphosphate, diacylglycerol transducer mechanism. And the LT1, BLT1 receptor has high, whereas BLT2 receptor have the lower affinity towards LTB4. Whereas the LT1 receptor is mainly expressed in the bronchial and intestinal muscle and has affinity for the other two type of the LTD4 and LTC4 type of the receptors. So the leukotrienes are also playing very important role in the inflammatory process of the body, and the primary location of this receptor is leukocytes and spleen, and it shows no preference over either LTB4 or LTC4. Okay, the LT1 receptor endowments the receptors Montelukast, Zephyrlukast, etc. are now very valuable drugs in the bronchial asthma. Especially in case of the asthma patients, the antagonists of the LT1 receptors, the drugs namely Montelukast and Zephyrlukast, are the classical examples of this category. And here you can see that the synthesis of the leukotriene is what you call as mentioned in a diagrammatic manner. So the stimuli to synthesis of the leukotriene is by the antigen, any antigen like allergen or any other drug. Then the immune complex or the IgE, cross-linked IgE and IgE. Then the microbes, the bacteria, the virus, and osmotic changes, and also the pollution. So these are all the stimuli which are the input for the leukotriene synthesis. So this is a leukocyte, and it has got the cytosol and the nucleus. So in the leukocyte, so since the leukotrienes are synthesized from the leukocytes, the phospholipids will be acted by phospholipase A2 enzyme, and the arachidonic acid is formed. Then because of this thing, the LT4 receptor or LT4 type of the leukotrienes are formed. Then this process is inhibited by the zeolitone, and whereas the LT4 is converted to LTB4, then it is acting on the different type of the receptors. Of course, here you can see that the LT4 is converted to LTC4, and LTC4 once again S and H, whereas the transporter proteins are putting these leukotrienes out of this particular nucleus, and they are going to act on different type of the leukotriene receptors. So here you can see that the LT1 type of the receptor, cystinyl, the LT2 and BLT2 and BLT1 type of the receptors are there, through which the LTB4 and LTD4 and LTE4 are going to act. So all these processes, especially the binding of the leukotrienes to the leukotriene receptor, is inhibited by this Montelukast, Zephyrlukast, etc., some of the drugs. And biological response, especially kinase activation, etc. So how the whenever the leukotrienes are acting on the particular endothelial cells, of course these are the target cells, and there will be GQ type of the proteins, and both GI type of the proteins are there. So GQ is the excitatory increased calcium influx is there, whereas the GI type of the receptors, the decreased cyclic AMP concentration will be there, whereas ultimately the biological response will be depending upon the kinin activation. So this is the very brief what you call as chart, which explains the action of different protein, different drugs on different type of the leukotriene synthesis and also the receptor binding sites. So here also this similar type of the chart is here prepared, and some of the drugs like Zilutown, they are going to act at different sites. So here you can see this is the nucleus of the and cytosol of a what you call as the leukocyte. This is the leukocyte, whereas the cytosolic phospholipase A2 will convert the arachidonic acid and do arachidonic acid. So the lipoxygenase pathway activating the protein, and this step is inhibited by Zilutown. Whereas the leukotriene A4 is synthesized, and from this leukotriene A4 to leukotriene B4 is synthesized, and the enzyme involved is epoxide reductase, whereas the leukotriene A4 is converted to leukotriene C4, and of course both of them are leaving the leukocyte and going to act on different effector cells. So here you can see that the different receptors are on the present on the different target sites, especially the airway smooth muscles, bronchial smooth muscles, and the different cell membranes, they have got the specific receptors, and the binding with that of the leukotriene D4 receptor, leukotriene E4 receptor and C4 receptors are going to act on the airway and going to cause the action, whereas the leukotriene B4 is going to act on the different cells and the chemotaxis is going to happen. And here you can see that the montelukast, zephyrlukast and primelukast, all these drugs are inhibiting the drug, inhibiting the leukotriene 2 bind with the cystinine LT1 receptor, and ultimately the action is stopped. So see here the so many anti leukotriene drugs are there. Of course the inhibitors of 5 lipoxygenase enzyme, and they block the FLAP, and so many drugs like MK-886, which is can be used in the atherosclerosis, and venetoclax and many other drugs are there. 5 lipoxygenase inhibitor, that's the Zilutown, is in the clinical use, whereas the antagonists of the LT1 type of the receptors are the montelukast, which is very commonly prescribed in case of allergies, different type of the allergies, and zephyrlukast and primelukast. All these three are the important drugs which inhibit the cystinine LT1 type of the receptors, and clinically they are used very commonly everywhere. And here you can see in what are all the conditions the drugs, especially the LT1 receptor antagonism and main pharmacological characteristic of this particular drug. So the first drug is montelukast sodium, and the mechanism of action is it is cis-LT1 receptor antagonist. So the indications of this drug are asthma, allergic rhinitis, and the benefits of this drug as a monotherapy in children with mild persistent asthma, particularly effective in exercise-induced asthma, and the allergic induced asthma. So varieties of the asthma can be treated with the montelukast sodium, and the side effects of this drug are the headache and sometimes the abdominal pain and possible association with the that is called as the Chirag-Strauss syndrome, and the dose is ranging from 10 milligram once a day, and it's a most widely prescribed CSLT1 receptor antagonist, especially for protein antagonist, so the Montelukast sodium, whereas the Translucast is also have the similar type of the properties to that of the Montelukast sodium, whereas the all the side effects and benefits are very similar, that allergy induced asthma and effective in case of the varieties of the asthma. And the dose is high, that's 225 milligram BID. So in case of Asia, it's marketed. Translucast is Asia continental, it's marketed. Whereas Zephyrlucast is also the CSLT1 receptor antagonist, and very specifically it is used in asthma. Especially it is used in the exercise induced asthma, means the persons who do more and more exercise suffering from asthma, they get attacks of the asthma, and at that time Zephyrlucast is administered, whereas the side effects are very similar to that of the other CSLT1 receptor antagonists, and also the Zelnutron is different drug. It is the 5-lipoxygenase inhibitor, and is also used in case of asthma. And ultimately, the leukotrienes are not formed by the Zelnutron, and particularly it's effective in exercise-induced asthma and allergy-induced asthma and many more. And the side effects are very similar to that of the earlier three drugs, but it is causing hepatic toxicity, Zelnutron, hence it is not so commonly used. And clinical use of the drugs, leukotriene antagonists, is restricted because of the limited availability, short lasting action. So, coming to the clinical uses of the eicosanoids, means yesterday we have said the agonists, especially in veterinary practice, PGF-12 analogs are used for the estrus synchronization program. So, varieties of the these particular drugs are used in case of estrus synchronization program or controlled breeding programs, and the induction of estrus in anestrus animals, that's also another use, and the expulsion of mummified fetus and expulsion of pus in pyometra. So these are all the common uses of the PGF2 alpha analog. And synchronization of estrus is very helpful in making the conception rate high in case of the cows, ewe, goat, buffalo, or what we can say is most of the ruminants. It's very useful in estrus synchronization. What is the meaning of synchronization? Means the animals are injected with the different doses of the eicosanoids, then they come into estrus at a time. That's the programmed estrus inducing program, or programmed estrus induction. And of course, in other diseases, it can also be used, expulsion of mummified fetus and expulsion of the pus in the pyometra. Of course, the therapeutic abortion in human females, the PGI2 analog, especially dinoprostan, is used for abortion using the pus trimester. And also, the in case of the males, PGE1 analog, aprostadil, may be used in the treatment of impotency. And maintenance of patent ductus arteriolysis is also another example. And PGE1 analog, that's the alprostadil. PGE1 analog alprostadil is used for the treatment of the congenital malformations of the heart in case of the neonates. And how the drug is going to cause the abortions is, when during the first trimester, termination of pregnancy by transcervical suction is the procedure of choice as present, but the intravaginal PGE2 pessary inserted 3 hours before attempting the dilatation is also to minimize the trauma to the cervix by reducing resistance to dilatation. and medical termination of pregnancy up to 6 weeks has been achieved with high success rate by administering mifepristone. This is not the important drug. 600 mg orally 2 days before a single oral dose of misoprostol 400 mg. So it's an alternative drug therapy for the manual procedure, and the uterine contractions are over and the concepts are explained within the next few hours. And intravaginal misoprostol is now favored by many as produces fewer side effects. And the drug can be absorbed through the sublingual routes, and ectopic pregnancy can be ruled out, and the uterine cramps, vaginal bleeding, nausea, vomiting and diarrhea are all the one of the few side effects of this particular drug. And methotrexate administered along with the misoprostol is highly successful in inducing abortion in case of the first few weeks of the pregnancy. And the prostaglandins have place in midterm abortion, fetal abortion, and molar gestation, and so many other problems. And medical treatment is more valuable than the other procedures. And especially in case of cattle and other animals, the prostaglandins are also used to augment the labor, and PGs do not offer any advantage over oxytocin to induction of the labor at term. That means the administration of oxytocin is enough for the treatment of the induction of the labor at the term, when the term is over, and they are less reliable and show wider individualization of the action. And PGE2 and PGF2 alpha have been used in place of oxytocin in toxemic and renal failure patients especially, and do not cause fluid retention, that's possible with the oxytocin. So if you administer the high dose of the oxytocin, of course the oxytocin receptors are present on the myometrium, which is preoccupied with the estrogen receptor. So the myometrial contractions are induced by the oxytocin, and whenever the dose is given high, it is going to retain water in the body. And PGE2 may also be used to augment the labor if it is slow in case of the primiparous animal. And intravaginal route of is also preferred now. Side effects are milder. Intramyotic route is infrequently used, of course. And cervical priming, also the prostaglandin analogs are applied intravaginally or in cervical canal, and low doses of the PGE2, which do not affect the uterine motility, make the cervix soft and compliant. And this procedure has yielded good results in cases with unfavorable cervix. So if needed, labor may be induced 12 hours later with oxytocin, and chances of failure are totally, they are reduced. And of course, whenever we are operating with the uterus of the animals, then there is a chance of postpartum hemorrhages. So this can be stopped by carboprostamitamine, and it's a 15-methyl PGF2 alpha analog. Injected IM is an alternative drug for control of the PPH, means postpartum hemorrhage due to uterine atony, especially in patients unresponsive to aromatin and oxytocin. Both treatment, if they are failed, then carboprost can also be used. And PGI2, that's the dinoprost or the Prostone E2 for induction of the labor, especially in case of the midterm pregnancy, can also be used. And the vaginal gel, 1 mg inserted into posterior fornix, then followed by 1 to 2 mg after 6 hours if it is required. And many pessaries like vaginal tablets, 3 mg inserted into posterior fornix, followed by another 3 mg if labor does not start within 6 hours. And the peptic ulcers, especially, they are the stable analog of the PGE1, the misoprostol. It is occasionally used for healing peptic ulcers, especially in patients who continue the NSAIDs, especially PGE1, PGE1 analogs are very commonly used for the peptic ulcer healing property. And the glaucoma also treated with the PGF12 analogs, PGF12 analogs like latanoprost, travoprost, and bimatoprost, that are the FP receptor, prostaglandin receptor agonists, are the first choice drugs in wide angle glaucoma. Yes, of course, to maintain the patency of the ductus arteriosus in neonates with congenital heart defects, till surgery is undertaken and the PGE1, that's the alprostadil, is used. But the side effects is the apnea, especially in case of few of the animals it may happen. And to apart from this one, so to avoid platelet damage, PDI2, androprostol, epoprostenol, it can be used to prevent platelet aggregation and damage during the hemodialysis, or the cardiopulmonary bypass can also be used. So it also improves the harvest of platelets for the blood transfusion whenever the platelets are required, especially in certain disorders where there is the deficiency of the platelets. Then few cases primary pulmonary hypertension have been successfully maintained on use of epoprostenol infusion. And the other suggested, apart from all these suggested, especially the other uses are peripheral vascular diseases, or PGI2 or PGE1, they are infused IV and can relieve rest pain and promote healing of ischemic ulcers in several cases of intermittent claudication and Raynaud's disease. So impotence, alprostadil and PGE1 injected into the penis causes erectile dysfunction treatment. So apart from this one, oral sildenafil and tadalafil now preferred for erectile dysfunction rather than these drugs. And the side effects of the prostaglandin analogs are very common, and of course the use of PGs, but their intensity varies with the type of the PG, the dose of the drug, and the route of the administration. And the common side effects are the nausea, vomiting, watery diarrhea, uterine cramps, unduly forceful uterine contractions, vaginal bleeding, flushing, shivering, etc. And all this falling BP, tachycardia, chest pain, this is very common in case of the dogs. So don't administer the PGF2-alpha in case of dogs without the prior intimation to the owner, or else as soon as the prostaglandin analogs are administered, the animals start vomiting, watery diarrhea, etc. Yes, of course, it is used in the case of treatment of the pyometra, but all the side effects should be noted. And the another attackroid is the platelet activating factor, the PAF. It's also known as the platelet activating factor. And just like eicosanoids, platelet activating factor is a cell membrane derived polar lipid intense biological activity. So PAF is also cell membrane derived and has got the proved as it has got the varieties of the biological activity. Of course, it's discovered in the 1970s. So it is active for the sub-nanomolar concentration, and now recognized to be an important signal molecule, especially the PAF. PAF is acetyl glyceryl ethyl phosphoryl choline. So the chemical property is the acetyl glyceryl ether phosphoryl choline, and the ether linked as alkyl chain in human PAF is mostly 16 or 18 C long. And this is the process how the PAF, platelet activating factor, synthesized from precursor of the phospholipids present in case of the cell membrane by the following reactions. So, membrane bound acyl glycerophospholipid is converted by phospholipase A2 enzyme with the converted to lyso-PAF, and of course PAF acetyl transferase is an enzyme which converts acetyl CoA to A, and the lyso-PAF is converted to platelet activating factor. So here the few of the enzymes are phospholipase A2 and PAF acetyl transferase. So the ultimately the lyso-PAF is converted to platelet activating factor, and the second step is rate limiting, and the antigen antibody reaction and a variety of the mediators similar stimulate the PAF synthesis in a calcium dependent manner or demand, and there are no preferred stores of PAF, and in contrast there are no storage sites. Of course, they are produced as and when they are required. So, in contrast to eicosanoids, the types of the cells which synthesize PAF is quite limited, mainly the WBC, platelets, vascular derived endothelium, etc., and kidney cells. So, the limited place it is produced but have a very important biological activity. What is the biological activity of the platelet activating factor? It has potent actions on many tissues and organs, especially the platelet aggregation and release reaction is very well monitored by the PAF, platelet activating factor. So it also releases thromboxinase 2, and IV injection of PAF results in intravascular thrombosis. And in case of WBC, PAF is a potent chemotactic for neutrophils, eosinophils and monocytes. So whenever there is inflammation, inflammatory reactions, it is having the chemotactic property of all the white blood cells, maybe the neutrophils, eosinophils and monocytes. So it stimulates neutrophils to aggregate, to stick to vascular endothelium and migrate across it to the site of infection. Whenever the bacteria enter the body and the inflammatory process starts immediately, so the PAF is released and it prompts the release of lysosomal, varieties of the lysosomal enzymes and leukotrienes, and going to cause the different mechanisms, especially it will generate the superoxide radical by the all these polymorphonuclear cells. The chemotactic action may be mediated through the release of leukotriene B4, and it induces the degranulation of the eosinophils. Here once again, for remembering it or regaining it, the PAF synthesis and the degradation will be by the process initiates by the action of the PLA2, phospholipase A2, that's the enzyme which is going to convert the membrane acyl glycerophospholipid, and also with presence of the fatty acids, it is going to be converted to lysoplatelet activating factor, and this is being acted by acetyl coenzyme A, and with the PAF acetyl transferase, this is converted to platelet activating factor. And the synthesis occurs, and next step is the degradation step. So the PAF is acted by acetate and acetyl hydroxylase enzyme. So once again it is the lyso-PAF is formed, and the fatty acids will be combined with this thing, and acyl glycerophospholipid is formed and get degradation to such products. And coming to the mechanism of action is the PAF. So PAF receptors are the transmembrane receptors, of course the transmembrane receptors, and the phospholipase C is there, and whenever it comes and binds PEF, platelet activating receptor is first of all, if it is going to be acted by the platelet activating factor, and so it initiates the action by varieties of the methods. The number one is the inositol triphosphate is converted to inositol diphosphate. It activates the diacylglycerol, and the calcium or protein kinase C both are activated, and hence from the intracellular calcium content will be increased, and varieties of the reactions will take place. So apart from this one also, the ATP is converted to ADP, and of course the PKA is activated, and this is the minor pathway, which whereas the major pathway is by PLC, PI2, IP3 and DAG. And the blood vessels, varieties of the endothelial derived relaxing factors, they are going to cause the vasodilatation, especially on the blood vessels, and cause the blood pressure to decrease if you administer the PAF IV. And decreased coronary blood flow has been observed in intracoronary injection. This may be probably due to the formation of the PAF aggregates and TXA2 or thromboxin A2. And please underline this thing, the PAF is the most potent known to increase the vascular permeability, means it is one of the most powerful inflammatory agent, and we love flare just like the histamines, as they do increase the wheel and flare response. It occurs at the site of intradermal injection. If you administer PAF intradermally, then a huge wheel and flare will be formed. So the PAF is aerosolized, which is a potent bronchoconstrictor. So it is very not indicated, especially in case of asthma patients. And in addition, it produces mucosal edema, secretion, and delayed and long-lasting bronchial hyper-responsiveness. So it stimulates, apart from this bronchium, so the intestinal smooth muscles are the one which do have the receptors of the PAF, and it stimulates intestinal and also the uterine smooth muscles, so that contraction or constriction occurs. And also in case of stomach, platelet activating factor is highly ulcerogenic. See, it is coming to the ulcerogenic property, this is also one of the strong ulcer inducing agent, and the erosions and mucosal bleeding occur shortly after IV injection. That's experimental, it is proved. The gastric smooth muscles, it is going to contract. The mechanism of action of the membrane-bound specific PAF receptor have been, now it is identified. The PAF receptor is a G protein coupled receptor which exerts most of the mechanism by coupling with GQ protein and generating intracellular messengers, especially the inositol triphosphate, the diacylglycerol and calcium release pathway. So whenever the intracellular IP3 is activated, then PIP2 is formed, whereas the diacylglycerol is activated and intracellular calcium is increased and released. So it can also inhibit adenylyl cyclase by coupling with G inhibitory type of the proteins. Hence, inhibitory action is initiated by the PAF in different tissues. So the many actions of the PAF are mediated or augmented by the prostaglandins, thromboxins A2 and LT, which may be considered as extracellular messengers. Yes, of course, all these prostaglandins, histamines, thromboxin A2 and the leukotrienes, they are considered as the inflammatory modules or modulators and considered as its extracellular messengers. and PAF also acts intracellularly, especially in the endothelial cells, and rise in PAF concentration within the endothelial cells is associated with the exposure of neutrophil binding sites on their surface. So this is a platelet activating factor is also acting as the chemotactic factor for the white blood cells in the body whenever there is an infection or foreign body entry. And of course, it is pro-aggregatory action in unmasking of fibrinogen binding sites of the surface of the platelet cells. So, fibrinogen binding means the fibrosis many times, especially in case of acute infections, acute inflammations of the udder. In case of mastitis, this occurs especially, the fibrinogen binding occurs especially on the plates of the surface of the platelets, and hence severe fibrosis occurs as early as possible. So this is having the pro-aggregatory action, the platelet acting factors. So many drugs are there which can augment the action of this drug and also to inhibit the action of the platelet activating factor antagonists. So many platelet acting antagonists are there naturally, and synthetic PAF receptor antagonists have been already investigated. An important among these are the ginkgolide B. The drug ginkgolide B from Chinese plant, and some structural analog of the platelet activating factor. The PAF antagonists have manifold therapeutic potential like treatment of the stroke, intermittent claudication, sepsis, myocardial infarction, shock, GI ulceration, asthma, and as the contraceptive, because the platelet activating factors are going to aggregate all these conditions: stroke, intermittent claudication, sepsis, myocardial infarction, and shock. All these are going to be blocked by PAF antagonists, and some of them have been tried clinically, but no one has found worth marketing. And of course, the alprazolam and triazolam antagonize some actions of the platelet activating factor. That's about the eicosanoids, leukotrienes, and platelet activating factor. And we will learn something about the renin angiotensin system. So we have already learnt the autocrat like the eicosanoids, the prostaglandins, PGE F2 alpha, PGE2, PGI2, and the leukotrienes, and also the platelet activating factors as the one of the important drugs which can be treated in several disorders. And the renin angiotensin system and plasma kinins are also some of the autocrats in case of autocrat pharmacology, and we have to know them in detail, especially the drugs affecting renin angiotensin system, or in short it is called as the ROS and the plasma kinins or PKs. So the drugs which are going to affect the renin angiotensin system can be used as the antihypertensive drugs, and many drugs are there which are very commonly used in the clinical practice. So here coming to the first one, that's the how it is synthesized, etc. Then the angiotensin 2 is a octapeptide generated in the plasma from the precursor plasma globulin, which is involved in electrolyte, blood volume, and pressure homeostasis. The active material is termed as the renin, and renin action was an inactive decapeptide angiotensin 1, which is converted to the active peptide, active octapeptide angiotensin 2, and by angiotensin converting enzyme, that's called as the ACE. ACEAs, and many drugs which are inhibiting the ACE can be very effectively used in blood pressure. And captopril is classical ACE inhibitor. So you can remember the captopril as one of the important inhibitor of the angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitor. And the renin angiotensin system is very much required for the maintenance of the body homeostasis, the blood pressure, the electrolyte balance, and all other processes of the normal living being. And the circulating renin angiotensin system is called as circulating, means it will be in the bloodstream, produced in the kidney, and it will be circulating in the blood. And normally the amount of renin in plasma acts as limiting factor for angiotensin 2 generation. Angio means half, and the plasma D half of the renin is 15 units. The biological potency of angiotensin 1 is only 1/100th of the angiotensin 2, the potency. But it's rapidly converted to the later, means angiotensin 2, by the ACE, especially angiotensin converting enzyme. And this ACE is present in vascular endothelial cells, especially in case of lungs. And circulating angiotensin 2 is also a very short half-life. That's the 1 minute half-life. The angiotensin has got very short half-life, whereas the angiotensin 2 has got the half-life of 15 minutes. This is the physiological regulation of electrolyte balance, plasma volume, and blood pressure by the renin angiotensin system, or it's also known as RAS system, R-A-S system. Here you can see that the angiotensinogen 1, it's a plasma alpha 2 globulin, is converted to angiotensin 1 or in the juxtaglomerular cells of the kidney, whereas the angiotensin 1 is converted to angiotensin 2 by the converting enzyme angiotensin kinase, or the vascular endothelium is relieved. And of course the angiotensin 2, it's also an octapeptide, so it causes the vasoconstriction, increases the blood pressure, and the other biological mechanisms like the vasoconstriction. And of course the amino peptidase is going to act on the angiotensin 2, and angiotensin 3 is formed with the enzyme amino peptidase. So this is angiotensin 3 is going to act on the adrenal cortex, and aldosterone is secreted, and sodium and water retention occurs in the kidney. So if sodium and water is increased, then increased blood volume will be present. Whereas the angiotensin 3 is converted to angiotensin 4, it's a hexapeptide. So actually the angiotensin 3 is converted to the inactive fragments with the help of the enzyme angiotensinase. And the same enzyme angiotensinase will act on angiotensin 4 also to form the inactive metabolites. So ultimate action is sodium chloride loss, fall in blood pressure, fall in the BP, and renal ischemia occurs whenever there is a low macula densa, sodium and chloride, and low glomerular afferent pressure will stimulate the renin. And once again all the same processes, conversion of angiotensin 81 to 82, then 82 and 84, all these cascades of the events will be started. So here, the angiotensin aldosterone system is present here, especially it is very important in the maintaining the blood pressure. And liver produces the angiotensin 1. So the it is going to angiotensin is involved in case of blood pressure maintenance. The kidney produces the renin, whereas the angiotensin the one is formed with the union of the then the ACE enzyme alone produces the angiotensin conversion enzymes. Then the also the vascular endothelial cells do also produce the ACE and it enters the blood and acts on the endothelial cells, especially the angiotensin 1 and ACE. In presence of ACE, it is converted to angiotensin 2 and the angiotensinogen is converting the angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. So the non-renin activity converts the angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. And the also with non-ACE or kinase activity, the angiotensin 2 is produced, which is going to have the activity. Apart from this one, ACE is also going to act on the bradykinin and ultimately brady means decrease. The nitric oxide synthesis is produced and it acts on the angiotensin 2 type of the receptors. So they are going to be activated and smooth muscles will be contracted. Yes, here we can see that the smooth muscle constriction will be seen by the angiotensin 2 enzyme. Whereas the aldosterone is released from the kidney and causes sodium retention and causes the increased blood pressure, which causes a negative feedback mechanism to release less renin. And angiotensin 1 receptor stimulation causes vessel constriction, sodium retention, water retention, and many other like the ROS formation. Whereas the angiotensin 2 receptors are also going to be acted with causing vasodilatation, cell proliferation, and many other responses, especially the angiotensin receptors. Another receptor, that's the angiotensin receptor 4, is being acted by angiotensin 2 in presence of all the other causes cell growth, proliferation, inhibition of the fibrolysis, stimulation of the other activities. So this is how the renin angiotensin system is going to act. And the first degradation product produced by the action of the aminopeptidases is the hepatopeptidase angiotensin 3 or ANG3. It is known as N3. It is 2 to 10 times less potent than angiotensin 2, except in stimulating the aldosterone secretion, which is equipotent. So all these are interrelated, renin, angiotensin and the aldosterone system. So this is a system which is regulated by the each other activity of the renin, angiotensin and angiotensin converting enzyme, that's the ACE, and angiotensin 3. All of these angiotensin 1, 2, 3 are biologically active. Of course, the 2 is active and attacked by another aminopeptidase and resulting in hexapeptide is called as angiotensin 4. Angiotensinogen is converted to angiotensin, then angiotensin 4 will also be formed. And angiotensin 4 has very different central and peripheral actions then elicited through the specific AT4 type of the receptors. Both angiotensin 3 and 4 are broken into inactive fragments by non-specific peptidases termed as angiotensinases. So these are also having some biological interference. So we have got many pharmacological sites starting from conversion of angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1, then 2, 3, 4. So and varieties of these types can be inhibited. Both angiotensin 3 and 4 are broken to inactive fragments, especially the degradation occurs by the angiotensinases. So this tissue local renin angiotensin system is also active, and the extrinsic local ROS or renin angiotensin system. So apart from the angiotensin generated in circulation as described above, blood vessels capture circulating angiotensinogen and renin to produce the ANG2 at the surface of their wall. And this angiotensin 2 diffuses to locally on the angiotensin receptors, producing the localized responses. So the intrinsic local ROS, mainly it is on the varieties of the tissues, especially heart, blood vessels, and brain, kidneys, adrenals process the capacity to synthesize all components of the renin angiotensin system. Of course, their cells are also produced, and they generate the angiotensin 1 and 2 intracellularly as per physiological need and pathological status. So these signal molecules are instrumental in regulating organ function, cell growth or hypertrophy, and cell death or apoptosis, and remodeling of the cells and fibrosis of cells. So all these are mediated by the renin angiotensin system. And pro-renin and pro-renin receptors. So renin is synthesized in extraglomerular cells of the kidney and in tissues expressing the local RAS or renin angiotensin system, say long peptide pro-renin. So pro-renin is very very active in response to the appropriate stimuli. Both pro-renin and renin are secreted. The former means pro-renin is much higher in quantities. The concentration of the pro-renin in circulation is 5 to 10 fold higher than that of the renin. Until recently, the pro-renin was considered to be the only inactive precursor of the renin. Oh, of course, the renin is very important in converting the angiotensinogen to angiotensin. Then, till recently, pro-renin was considered to be only one inactive precursor of renin, but now it is recognized to be active in its own right. Earlier, it was thought that it is not active, but pro-renin is now found to be very active, and activation of pro-renin and augmentation of the renin in tissues, it happens by varieties of the mechanisms as usual. So pro-renin is converted to renin and vice versa is also formed, and the enzymatic activation of pro-renin is going to yield the renin, and renin is going to convert the angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1, whereas the non-enzymatic action also converts the angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1. The renin in the presence of this pro-renin, then the non-enzymatic augmentation causes the conversion of angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1, and subsequently when angiotensin 1 is converted to angiotensin 2, and it is going to act on the specific type of the receptors. And here you can see the varieties of the actions of the renin angiotensin aldosterone system. All these three, RAS, renin angiotensin aldosterone system, is going to have the coordinated action, especially the angiotensinogen converting enzyme or ACE, angiotensinogen converting enzyme or ACE is going to convert the angiotensin 1 to 2, whereas the renin is going to act on angiotensinogen, which is a precursor of angiotensin 1. Then this angiotensinogen angiotensin 2 is going to cause the vascular constriction, and from the kidney the aldosterone is going to be formed, and the aldosterone is going to act on the varieties of the cells on the heart, and it increases the heart rate, and the blood volume, total blood volume is will increase, whereas the cardiac output will be increased, and ultimately it is leading to the increase in blood pressure. Whereas the beta blockers are going to block this action. The vasomotor active centers, especially in the brain, are also having the control on the blood pressure, so that they are going to release varieties of the substances, and ultimately cardiac output will be increased and blood pressure is increased. That means all the activity of this ROS system, renin angiotensinogen and aldosterone system, is going to increase the BP, increase the blood pressure. Whereas the any drug which is acting on the ACE or the conversion of this angiotensin 1 to 2 or any steps which inhibit these steps is going to be act as a very good anti-hypertensive drug. So these are one of the most popular anti-hypertensive drugs. Pro-renin is activated both enzymatically and non-enzymatically. The enzymatic activation is carried out by the proteases like proconvertase or cathepsin B, which cleavage of hindering the propeptide to produce renin with its exposed catalytic domain. So this action is irreversible. Especially the non-enzymatic and reversible activation occurs by the binding pro-renin to another cell surface protein called as the pro-renin receptors, or PRRs are known as the pro-renin receptors, because it binds with the renin, because it's a very specific receptor to renin. The PRR or pro-renin receptor is richly expressed on heart, blood cells, blood vessels, kidney, brain, eye and liver. And binding of pro-renin to pro-renin receptors so brings about a conformational change. The propeptide segment unfolds, and the several folds increase, and the pro-renin and renin can dissociate from the pro-renin receptors to retain their original state after the biological activity is over. And apart from this one, there are non-enzymatic activation of the pro-renin, which is always play a major role in the ROS, where pro-renin exerts the effects via angiotensinogen 2 dependent and angiotensinogen 2 independent pathway. Both pathways are being acted by this particular process. And here you can see, this is a flow diagram in which you can see that there are two pathways, angiotensin 2 independent pathway and angiotensin 2 dependent pathway are there. Then here the non-enzyme pathway, independent pathway, intracellular signaling will increase the MAP kinase and PAI1 and Janus kinase, all these enzymes are activated. Of course, the non-enzymatic conversion of angiotensinogen 1 with the enzyme ACE, it is converted to angiotensinogen 2, and all this activation of the MAP kinase, PAI1, platelet, and Janus kinase 2, STAT transmissions, and varieties of the protocogenes are activated. So ultimately this is related to the cell growth, fibrosis, apoptosis, and remodeling of the myocardium vascular muscles, especially during this nephropathy and retinopathy. So this is the pathway how pro-renin and renin are going to act on the pro-renin receptors. Of course, the renin is also going to act on the PRR and non-enzymatic conversion of the angiotensin origin 1 and 2 occurs, whereas the intracellular signal is going to activate the MAP kinase and many other intracellular substances. So this is also another chart which informs about the inhibition of the ROS system. What happens is the renin angiotensin system is one of the important system. The aldosterone secretion increases the output of the potassium, then the sympathetic stimulation causes the increased peripheral vascular dilatation, and because of this thing the cardiac output will be increased. Of course, the venous supply is also increased, then the receptors, especially the angiotensinogen 2 receptors, are activated, which in turn causes the act on the vascular endothelium and causes the constriction. And angiotensinogen 2 or alpha globulin is related with the renin and also the prorenin. Prorenin, both are acting on the renin receptors. The ACE inhibitors like captopril and enalapril, they are going to inhibit the enzyme ACE or angiotensinogen 1 to angiotensinogen 2 converting enzyme, and will be very effective in formation of the antihypertensive drugs. So apart from this one, the angiotensinogen 2 pathway is there. Activation of prorenin and renin generates angiotensinogen 1, which is converted to 2 by ACE. The angiotensinogen 2 acts on AT receptors and tissue cells to produce effects of the cell growth. And angiotensinogen 2 independent pathway is also going to act on the different type of the cell activation by the MAP kinase, plasminogen activator factor inhibitor, that's the PAI, Janus kinase and STAT pathway. So all these cascades of events are activated by the angiotensinogen 2 independent pathway. So apart from this one, there is alternative pathway of angiotensinogen 2 production that you have seen in the particular diagram. So in addition to primary pathway described above, small quantities of the angiotensinogen 1 and 2 can be produced from angiotensinogen by the action of other proteases like cathepsin. And moreover, the kinase can convert the angiotensinogen 1 to 2, particularly in heart and kidney. So because of this thing, the cardiac rate will be increased and also the kidney. Then the angiotensinogen peptides are there, and the angiotensinogen ANG2 and ANG3, some other biologically active antagonism peptides, are produced in small quantities whose physiopathological role is not well understood, of course. And all these, the angiotensinogen 1, 2, 3, 4, they are effective in regulation of the blood pressure and different type of the, what you call as the, of course, angiotensinogen 4 improves the memory and it enters the brain. So the